Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, dear friend, dear Yedan, in particular, thank you very much for inviting me to this exciting event. It's really very inspiring, and not only because of the talks and the many discussions that we have, but also because of the building, which immediately led me to think about which layer, which cortical area, which species I see when I see this this beautiful building. And I would really like to give you now an overview about our work, which starts with this hydroarchitecture, but which is driven and motivated, of course, by the fact that the brain is one of the most complex and most interesting organs. And we have these 86 or 100 billion neurons with many synapses. We have a lot of wiring. The brain is capable to learn. It is creating incredible skills. It has a relatively small volume, consumes only 10 watt, and is functioning quite long without any spare parts. So this is incredible. On the other hand, the brain is also undergoing diseases and changes during aging, which are not always good for us. And here you see an example of a brain undergoing a neurodegenerative disease called primary progressive aphasia. And there are many, many diseases which concern our life in a significant way, and which create, for instance, loss of language or changes in personality, and so on and so forth. And this plays an ever-increasing role. And when we think about brain research, we also have to reflect, of course, how to help patients, yeah, and to come up with new therapies, for instance. And in order to come up with new diagnostic tools or new therapies, we have somehow to identify the relationship between the different levels of organization of the brain, and also the relationship between a certain feature of brain organization and then its relevance to symptoms. And this makes this, of course, very difficult. If you think about stroke, it's very important where the stroke is in the human brain. So it has quite different consequences. And one approach that we selected in Düsseldorf and Jülich quite for some time, this is, we selected to start this research by developing a map or a new kind of atlas. And the question is, what does it mean, new kind of atlas? We have seen Brodmann's map several times in talks. Well, one of the first features, I would say, is an atlas also of the human brain should be very accurate. And when we see here Vasco da Gama's flagship, he had very good maps. He had a very precise understanding of the size of the continent, and he ended up with his endeavor in India, where he wanted to go, while Christoph Columbus, who would like to take the same journey, he ended up in the United States. And of course, this was also a big event and a challenge, and perhaps we know him better than Vasco da Gama. But also think about your funders. Are they excited when you say you want to go to India, but then, I mean, you end up in America? So it's of course always important to know where you are, what are the constraints that drive you, and that then help you also to develop a roadmap. And Humboldt was one of the first mappers, again, not in the human brain, but in geography. And he wrote a very nice book and considered different aspects of the organization of a brain region. So he not only delineated countries and continents, but he had also a profile of the height of mountains, and he projected the different plans to different levels of height. And this is, in my view, this is the first multimodal atlas that we see in Humboldt's work. And when we started to do our mapping project, we started with cytoarchitecture. And to give you an impression, so this is how we cut human postmortem brains, or the brains of other animals, and they are cut into 20 micrometer thick sections. We use a very large microtome. And as you can see, this is quite a challenging work, and not every section is okay. Not every brain can be cut. It really requires a lot of handwork and experience to process like that, but then we are in a situation to process whole human brains. And in my view, this is very important because the brain is an organ. Yeah, it's good and important to focus on small regions of interest, but at the end, we would like to understand the organ as a whole. And we are mapping the brain based on cytoarchitecture. So you see here again the cytoarchitectonic horizontal sections through a whole human brain. And in the frontal pole, and Roger Mars has just shown an example what in the frontal pole is happening, we identified two areas, FP1 and FP2, where Brodmann only identified one area. So this is area 10. So why it is important? It is not only important because anatomists always like to have it very detailed and fine-grained, but because it has consequences. So when you have a look at the higher magnification, this is the cerebral cortex, all the neurons are stained here in black, then you can see that at this position, there is a change in the pattern in the distribution of neurons. And this is, for instance, true for the distribution of neurons in layer 3, which is the outer pyramidal cell layer. And there are other characteristics. And the big advantage that we have now as compared to Brodmann is that we can measure such differences in cytoarchitecture. So we are using the Mallard-Nobis distance as a multivariate measure describing the distribution of cells from the surface to the white matter boundary. And this helps us to identify the position of borders when we scan, so to say, across the cortical ribbon. And this is a way how we analyze serial histological sections in both hemispheres and in several brains. Why in several brains? Well, because human brains are very variable. And you see here the 3D reconstruction of these two areas, FP1 and FP2 in 3 brains out of 10. And when we then align these brains to a common reference space, which is a MNI reference space, and many of you who are doing diffusion or functional imaging, they use a MNI space. We superimpose the individual maps, and then we calculate so-called probabilistic maps, which indicate for each voxel of the reference space the probability with which a certain cortical area is present or is not present. And this is a very time-consuming process, and one needs about one person year, in order to map one area in 10 human brains. And there is not really a good possibility to scale it up. Yeah? It is as slow as it is. So everybody is invited to help us to map the brain, considering that we have mapped maybe 70% of the brain, including also subcortical nuclei, and we estimate that the cortex has 150 areas or maybe even more. It's difficult to estimate it because the brain area have very different sizes, and where Brodmann thought or assumed that there's only one area, we find 5 of them, and you never know when you come into a new brain region what happens there. So in order to make these maps also easy available, we have developed an atlas, and this atlas also includes so-called maximum probability map, and Simon Eickhoff has had as a young student the idea to develop a toolbox and to calculate these maximum probability maps, which are also based on 10 human brains. So this is not a new Brodmann map, just color-coded, so this is mapping in 10 human brains. And then you can take these maps in order to better understand the function of areas and the development of areas. And this is an example of collaboration which we had with Stanford and Jerusalem here. So we analyzed the so-called fusiform face area in children and in adults and superimposed for the analysis the maps that we did in Jülich with respect to this region. These are the areas FG2 and FG3, and we are extracting certain profiles from the cerebral cortex which show how the cytoarchitecture is changing when you move from the pile surface to the white matter boundary, and such information is very helpful in order to interpret also MR signals and to come up with conclusions about the functional relevance of certain architectonic changes during autogeny. and we see that the face selective region, but not the place selective region, is dominated by tissue growth. So we really see differences between the brain areas. And these areas are summarized in Brodmann's map as one big area. And for me, it is a little bit, if one says this is Brodmann area 20 or Brodmann area 19, even worse, this is a little bit like when you say, I'm going to have vacation in Europe. You know, that's, what does it mean? Are you on the Baltic Sea? Are you looking to Florence? What are you doing? So it's very imprecise. And the same is true for the architectonic areas. They do have specific functions, which we do not understand, of course, fully. And we need precise information about the segregation in order to better address the functions using imaging, for instance. And one of the most fascinating brain regions where we analyze this relationship between function and anatomy, this is Broca's region, and I started my career with mapping Broca's region. And this is an overview of six hemispheres of the left and of the right side. And you see here areas 44 and areas 44. And what was apparent from the first moment, there's huge intersubject variability in the size and extent of the areas, in the localization of the borders of the areas to the surrounding sulci, but also with respect to the sulci. So that means if you have a certain gyrus, opercular part, you cannot predict where are the borders of the areas. So you are more or less sure that the opercular part is occupied by 44 and the triangular part by 45, but you never know where their border is. And considering that the sulci are very deep, 1 centimeter, you have a lot of uncertainty if you just rely on these sulci. And in addition, these sulci are variable and they do not indicate precisely, again, where the border is in principle. So 44 and 45 can be separated by the diagonal sulcus, but the diagonal sulcus may be also within 44, but there are also hemispheres, 50%, where there is no diagonal sulcus at all. So this is not a good indicator. And for many higher associative area, this is the case. And this intersubject variability, of course, also poses problems when we think about comparative analysis and when we want to see what are the homologs of certain areas in the human brain as compared to brains of apes or of monkeys. And this is, again, here the human brain, and which has an inferior frontal sulcus. It also has a precentral sulcus, but these sulci are not present in the gibbon, for instance, and in the Mokaka mulatta. So the question is really how to relate this area to each other. Or most of the apes do have an orbital frontal sulcus, but the human brain does not have an orbital frontal sulcus. And so many, many maps that we have, for instance, for the monkey brain, they are oversimplified in their cytoarchitectonic or architectonic segregation, and it is really not easy to identify the homologous region. So, I mean, how to approach this question? Obviously, when the sulci look so different and the cytoarchitecture is perhaps also not good enough to explain everything, we can go to other data modalities. And this is an example of the molecular organization of the human brain. More precisely, you see here different binding sites of neurotransmitter system. So for acetylcholine, two different receptors, M1 and M2. Here is a glutamatergic receptor kinate and a GABA-A receptor for GABA. And the different color codes indicate the concentrations of these particular receptor types in the human brain. And as you can see, these are neighboring sections. And we analyze these receptor distributions not only for one receptor type, but usually for 20, and come up with a multimodal description of receptor architecture in the human brain. And you can see that the receptor architecture allows to identify borders between different brain regions, but it also shows, for instance, laminar differences. So some receptors have a higher concentration
for instance, here in the supralaminar layers and lower in the infragranular layers, and vice versa. So you have all the full richness of information of molecular concentrations in the human brain. And of course, this is very interesting, not only functionally, but also with respect to patients, when we think that all the drugs are binding to certain receptor binding sites, and the receptor binding sites have so different distributions in the human brain. But coming back to the mapping aspect, these receptors helped us to identify parcellation in the ventral prefrontal cortex that goes far beyond what Brodmann has proposed with areas 44 and 45 and perhaps 47. So we have identified here more than a dozen different areas. And in the last talk, you got a flavor that this is also important in terms of connectivity, that these areas which differ in their cytoarchitecture and receptor architecture, they also have differences in their connectivity. And this, of course, again poses a question: what is Broca's region, yeah, which makes it so unique in many sense as compared to other regions? But when we have a good map, we can start to analyze, of course, not only the classical Broca region, but also regions which are neighboring. So for instance, here we have mapped an area in the anterior insular cortex, and this was based on a functional imaging study that Josip Rozhinsky and his team have come up, and you will hear more about it tomorrow. So this area seems to be critically involved in logical operations, not so much in language operations, and to having, so to say, both modalities and combining both modalities, we can ask really more precisely what is the function, what is the functionality of a certain region, but we also can better understand what does it mean to analyze language. So what are the processes? And of course, many of such data are necessary in order to come to a more comprehensive understanding. And many of such studies require an enormous amount of work. And Kathleen Rockland has mentioned some of the work. I mean, if you are starting tracing, it's really, painstaking. And there are many other things which require a lot of capacities. And it's not only a question that it takes a very long time, it's also a question of bringing all these different data and knowledge together in order then to ask questions how they are related to each other. And this is the background, or this was one of the motivations to overcome the fragmentation that we very often have for the creation of the Human Brain Project, which is a 10-year project with an estimate of 1 billion total funding. We have organized the project in such a way that we have 12 different sub-projects, which are disciplinary sub-projects. We have released 2 years ago 6 research platforms which can be used. I will show a few examples of them. And we were in the position to do it because there were various initiatives in front of this HBP which contributed to the development of the HBP. But it's a little bit like the journey of Vasco da Gama. And where we are with respect to this journey, well, the ramp up phase was the official start of the project, and the group led by Henry Markram was able to successfully deliver a proposal which was evaluated really several times, many times. And it was a huge effort which started much more earlier than 2013. So we are now at the so-called start of specific grant agreement phase number 2. So we are more or less in the middle of the project, and we would hope that we will be in a situation of providing a joint platform for neuroscientists for collaborating in the fields of neuroscience, but also simulation, neuromorphic computing, high-performance computing, robotics, and so on and so forth, with the European community. And why this is so necessary? Well, this is so necessary because the brain has a multi-level type of organization. It's a very complex system. And this organization starts from gene. It goes through single neurons, of course, with their different activities. It goes to the microcircuit level, to the level of the so-called mesoscopic scale, to the more macroscopic level. There is dynamic information. There is information about networks connecting different brain areas. And at the end, I mean, we are not interested only in the brain. We are interested in behavior. And there is a certain periphery that the brain needs in order to communicate and in order to contact. And how to address such challenge, such multi-scale challenge? Well, we are addressing it by experiments, but also by theory and model, and this is very important in order to bridge the different scales. So models can do that, can help us in that respect. And this is supported by a research infrastructure which includes medical and neuroinformatics, simulation, atlasing, robotics, but also computing, including neuromorphic or HPC. And the atlas is one part of this endeavor, and we have provided from our lab an atlas based on the so-called Big Brain Project, and this is a 20 micrometer isotropic representation of a human brain, which is now accessible through the website, and you can play with this brain, and you can also introduce oblique sectionings online. It works very nice. There are other template spaces, for instance, a so-called Colin brain, and you see here the different maps, cytoarchitectonic maps. You see here, for instance, projected the localization of certain electrodes of patients with epilepsy, because we, of course, want to consider not only anatomical features, but also dynamic features about physiology. And our job is it now to more and more populate the atlas, which is, again, very time-consuming, but I'm convinced that this is the right way to share data and to help also to come to new insights to the human brain organization. And is this really necessary to have a micrometer or a big brain like this? Yes, I think it is necessary. And one of the motivation is that MR imaging is now so precise that it goes down to the 200, 300 micrometer level, so we can really watch the living human brain. And this is an example from Rainer Goebel's team where people see ambiguous moving stimuli, and you can see how the different columns are switching independent whether the people see the stimulus in one or the other way. And of course, it's also necessary in order to include the lower levels of description, like the cellular level or even subcellular. And one important step is, in my view, also to combine such type of data with genetic data. And this is an example of a nice collaboration that we have with the Ellenbrain Institute, and where we use the rich data sets that Ellenbrain is providing with respect to gene expression and combine it with cytoarchitectonic maps and then ask specific questions of how different brain regions which are involved in a certain pathological process or which have a different connectivity, so how it is related to the genes. And this is one of the tools that is available. On the other hand, when we are moving towards a cellular level of brain organization, we have a big data problem when we speak about the cellular, the whole brain approach. So one brain slice with a resolution of 1 micrometer has a huge size of 200,000 pixels, and this sums up to 2 petabyte per brain, and 2 petabyte is just a horrible number of bytes that has to be stored. And of course, we do not want to store it, simply we want to analyze it, we want to approach it. And how to analyze it? Well, one possibility that comes more and more into the focus of neuroscientists is to use deep learning networks. And here you see 2 neighboring sections. So they are directly neighboring, but since we have cut them physically, we have also cut some of the sections. So half of the section is in the half of the cell is in the first section, half of the cell is in the second section. And using deep learning, we can now identify, so to say, the two pieces and then bring them together in order to 3D reconstruct then the different parts of the sections. Oh, okay, I have music. I wasn't there. And
okay, so this is the first time I hear it. Came to Israel to hear the music. Okay, so deep learning helps us very much to identify it. And what you see here are a couple of physical sections. And in each physical sections, we have 30 virtual sections. And what you then see here, these are the four physical sections, 3D reconstructed. So we can really see where the different cell bodies are located. And this is, of course, a very nice perspective that opens up using deep learning networks to have this 3D reconstruction and really go down to the cellular level. And therefore, in my view, this combination of neuroscience and computing is a win-win situation. And this is not only true for data analytics, the same is true for simulation, which is, of course, also getting more and more complex, involving more and more biological constraints, which are important, which have to be taken into account.
So in the last part of my talks, I would like to note also or mention that, of course, cytoarchitecture, this is cool, and we would like to better understand how the networks of cells are formed, but we need also to go to the fiber architecture. And for the human brain, this is again very, very difficult because all these nice tracing techniques, they more or less do not work in the human brain. So we use a method that came up more than 100 years ago using polarimetry. And we have two different systems, a large-scale polarimeter and a PLI microscope. PLI is for polarized light imaging. So with a microscope, we can again acquire very large images with a very high spatial resolution, but this ends up with 6 or 8 hours to image only one section. And the human brain has about 2,000, 3,000 sections, so it depends how you cut it. So these are, of course, really dimensions which are difficult to be addressed. It has a different quality in the human brain as compared to brains of other animals. And this is here a comparison of a rat brain, then of a velvet brain, and of a human brain. But apart from the differences in the size that we are acquiring, I would like also to put your attention to the fact that with respect to fiber architecture, these three brains are so different in their architecture that it's really important to consider these differences also on the system level of the human brain. So the rat has not really a lot of white matter, and Yaniv has pointed out how difficult it is to distinguish. This is a little bit better in the vertebrate brain, and the white matter in the human brain has, of course, a very large volume. And in order to better understand also what are the homologies and what are the relationship between the different species, I think that we should also use, if possible, one and the same method to analyze the different species. And this is very time consuming again, but it helps us, of course. And this is the first attempt where we collaborated with Francesco Pavone at Silence and have two photon microscopy or light sheet imaging, and then the same specimen is put into the PLI microscope, and we are getting such images, and the colors indicate the direction of fibers in plane, and the more black the color is, the steeper is the orientation of the fibers in the third dimension. But bringing these things together, in my view, helps very much to better understand the human connectome, to eliminate artifacts, to inform, so to say, the different methods, each other, what are some constraints on the different levels. So I would like to show you this as an example that we have now 3D reconstructed 230 different coronal sections of a vertebrate brain. So this is from the visual cortex. This is a calcarine sulcus. And the quality is not so great, but you can really see single axons here in 3D. So these little worms, these are capillaries. So here you have the primary visual cortex and you see the axons, not all are visualized because it would be simply too dense. But this is the way how we would see that we can inform also other communities about connectivity in the human brain or in the macaque brain. So these are only a few examples of many that we address in the human brain project, and you have heard Hype Mansfelder, you know Jordan Seger's work, you will hear tomorrow by Henry Markram. So these are all PIs from the HPP. And I would like to conclude that perhaps the HPP is maybe not such a flagship, but we should think about the HPP perhaps a little bit in a different way. So it's more like this, perhaps. And this is necessary in order to better understand the human brain. And I thank you for your attention.
Questions? Maybe I will start. Oh, there is a question there? I will start. Can you relate the connectivity map that you show us in the end with the tito architectonic differentiation in the cortex?
Yes, we can. There are two possibilities. First of all, in these unstained histological sections, which we use for polarized light imaging, we see cell bodies. Of course, not so nice as when we stain it, but we see them, so this is direct one-to-one relationship. And we are also working on methods to restain the sections and to then better visualize it. So both is feasible, and of course, we would like to bring both sides together.
Thanks a lot. But I have a question just to add to this tremendous work. Are there any plans to look at the developing brain? Because it would be, of course, incredibly useful to see how this histological map develops.
Yeah, so honestly, I started my career, so my PhD thesis was development in children during normal autogeny and in cerebral palsy. And we see a lot of development, particularly in the first year postnatally, but also then, and the brain is constantly changing throughout the whole lifespan. I also convinced that we should address the children, our child brain, because it's not just a small adult brain. It's time consuming, and yeah, fortunately, it's very difficult to get children's brain. So these are methodical, technical questions, but I think we should also focus our activities to brains of children, for instance, to help for pre-surgery planning and in such cases.
Thank you very much. For consideration of time, I think we should move to the panel. So, lecture again to Catherine.